할렐루야. 아멘. 이 시간 7월 18일 목요 구국 예배 드리시기 전에 우리 먼저 찬양으로 우리 마음을 준비하도록 하겠습니다. 이 시간 먼저 함께 기도하시겠습니다. 참 감사하신 아버지 하나님, 오늘도 이 나라 민족을 위해 기도하는 목요 구국 예배로 우리의 발걸음 인도하여 주심이 진심으로 감사를 드립니다. 이 나라 대한민국이 한치 앞을 내다볼 수 없는 여러 가지 어려움에 처해 있는 가운데 있지만, 이 나라 민족을 위해 기도하는 평강의 성도, 믿음의 성도들이 있사오매 이 나라 대한민국을 끝까지 지켜주시고 옳은 길로 인도하여 주시옵소서. 오늘 예배 가운데 여러 가지 삶 가운데 기도 제목을 가지고 나왔습니다. 아버지 하나님, 기도할 때에 우리 각자 한 사람 한 사람을 권고하여 주시고 속히 응답하여 주시옵소서. 모든 것 맡겨오며 거룩하신 우리 주 예수님의 이름으로 감사 기도드리옵나이다. 아멘. 이 시간 함께 마음이 상한 자를 우리 함께 찬양으로 고백하시겠습니다. 마음이 상한 자를,
마음이 상한 자를 고치시는 주님, 하늘의 아버지, 나를 주관하소서. 주의 길로 인도하사 자유케 하소서. 새 일을 행하사 부흥케 하소서. 마음이 상한 자를 고치시는 주님, 주관하소서. 주의 길로 인도하사 자유케 하소서. 새 일을 행하사 부흥케 하소서.
세달 열어주소서.
예, 그리고
그
고백합니다. 의에 주리고 목이 마르니
의에 주리고 목이 마르니 성령의 기름 부소서 의에 주리고 목이 마르니 내 잔을 채워 주소서.
할렐루야. 함께 찬양합니다. 아름다운 이야기가 있네.
아름다운 이야기가 있네. 구세주의 사랑 이야기. 영광스런 천국 떠난 사람 나와 같은 죄인 구하려 주님의 그 사람 정말 놀랍네 놀랍네 놀랍네. 오 주님의 그 사랑 정말 놀랍네 나를 위한 그 넓고 넓은 우주 속에 있네. 많고 많은 사람들 중에 구원받고 보호받은 이로 주의 사랑
다시 한번 찬양하며
넓고 넓은 우주 속에 있네. 많고 많은 사람들 중에
구원받고
보호받은 이로 주의 사랑 받고 산다네.
아멘.
주님의 그 사랑 정말 놀랍네 놀랍네 놀랍네. 오 주님의 그 사랑 정말 놀랍네 나를 위한 그 사랑. 사람들은 이해할 수 없네 주를 보낸 하나님 사랑. 그 사랑이 나를 살게 하네 갈보리의 구속의 사랑.
사랑이 나를 살게 하네
사랑이 나를 살게 하네 갈보리의 구속의 사랑. 주님의 그 사랑 정말 놀랍네 놀랍네 놀랍네. 오 주님의 그 사랑 정말 놀랍네 나를 위한 그 사랑.
주님의 그 사랑은
주님의 그 사랑 정말 놀랍네 놀랍네 놀랍네. 주님의 그 사랑 정말 놀랍네 나를 위한 그 사랑.
주 하나님
주 하나님 독생자 예수 날 위하여 오시었네. 내 모든 죄 다 사하시 예수
날 위하여
오시었네. 내 모든 죄 다 사하시고 죽음에서 부활하신 나의 구세주
살아계신 주
살아계신 주 나의 참된 소망 걱정 미신 전혀 없네.
승리합니다. 그 언젠가 죽을 때까지
주를 위해 싸우리라. 승리의 길 멀고 험해도 주님께서 나의 앞길 지켜주시리.
아멘.
살아계신 주 나의 참된 소망 걱정
I believe our living Father God will truly guide every step of way for us in our church and our nation. Let us pray for our nation at this time and all the leaders. Also, secondly, let us pray for our church. We are about to begin our summer conference as well as the minister summer conference. Let us really unite our hearts in prayer for this. And lastly, let us really confess all of our prayer requests before our God. When we pray, our Father God, who is our true living hope, will take away all of our worries and anxieties. Let us confess our faith until the day He returns and pray together.
십자가
고맙고 감사하신 하나님 아버지 감사합니다.
Our Father God, how we are so thankful to you. You have led us to this Thursday worship service for our nation. So that we can come before you by faith and worship you in truth and spirit. And Father, we thank you so much for the special privilege of being able to worship you. Father, please comfort those hearts that are hungering, thirsting for your grace. And fill us with all the good things that can come only from above.
하나님의 강권적인 은혜로 이렇게 많은 주의 종들이 이 자리로 불러 모아주심에 참으로 감사함을 드리옵나이다. 늘 영권 목회 승리할 수 있도록 역사하여 주시고 교회마다 더욱 부흥할 수 있도록 붙잡아 주시고 인도하여 주시옵소서. 나라와 민족을 위해서
Father,
기도합니다. 모든 왕들의 마음이 아버지의 손에 있음을 믿사오니 대통령과 위정대들을 끝까지 붙잡아 주시고 이 나라 아버지의 뜻대로 이끌어갈 수 있도록 인도하여 주시옵소서.
So they can truly govern this nation in accordance with their will. Grant them a heavenly wisdom so that with a good conscience they can discern good and evil in order to ultimately protect our free democracy. Father, there are many evil schemes are trying to crush our nation. Father, may you make all those evil schemes obsolete so the nation can truly march forward to fulfill your good will that you have bestowed upon this nation. Father, there are many history redemption seminars are being held around the world. We pray that the history redemption seminars will become your channel to spread your good word to all the nations and the gospel of Jesus Christ cover the remotest part of this world by your grace.
we lift up our summer conference and the Minister Summer Conference.
Through this prayer, we pray that you will govern every step of the preparation for these special events so that may no power of darkness will ever penetrate into our hearts as we prepare for this. Let no people become ever grow weary or tired in the process of preparing so that all of us can come and receive the unprecedented blessings that you have prepared for the summer conference. Fill us whatever is needed and that there may be a complete preparation and to give you all the glory to you. Father, we have heard that many saints and pastors from all the world, when your word is translated, we pray there's nothing in hindrance, but everything will be delivered just as you intend, that all of us can be greatly blessed. As Deborah Choir, sing your name. Father, may there be a highway of Zion straight to your word. We pray that you will empower Senior Pastor Philip Lee about to proclaim your word. Please empower him with the Holy Spirit so they can preach the word of absolute power from our Father God. We thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let us all rise and sing the National Anthem, verses 1 and 4, and the Song of Unification.
Thank you. 생명 양식 하나님의 말씀은 예레미야서
Today's word of life comes from Jeremiah chapter 3 verse 16.
예레미야서
Jeremiah chapter 3 verse 16.
제가 봉독하겠습니다. 나 여호와가 말하노라
It shall be in those days when you multiplied and increased in the land, declares the Lord. They will no longer say the ark of the covenant of the Lord, and it will not come to mind. Nor will they remember it, nor will they miss it, nor will it be made again. This is the word of God. Amen. Deborah Choir will sing the choral anthem.
감사합니다. 우리 더보라 성가대.
Thank you very much, our Deborah Choir has sung truly such gracious choral anthem to give glory to our Father God. Today is the 14th lecture concerning Zerubbabel's temple. And the title will be The Temple Without the Ark of the Covenant. The Temple Without the Ark of the Covenant. Jeremiah chapter 3, verse 16.
자, 하나님께서 역사상 많은 성전들을
Throughout history, God built many temples, such as Moses' tabernacle,
그다음에,
and Solomon's temple.
그리고 이제 솔로몬성이 파괴된 다음에
And after the Solomon's temple was destroyed, the Israelites returned from the Babylonian captivity and built the Zerubbabel's temple.
그리고 이 스룹바벨 성전이 주전
And the Zerubbabel's temple
개축 크게 다시
was actually remodeled in great scale in AD 20 BC 20 in 20 BC, and this remodeled version of Zerubbabel's temple is known as Herodian Temple, the Herod's Temple. So for a tabernacle and Solomon's temple did have the Ark of the Covenant. However, in Zerubbabel's temple, there was not the Ark of the Covenant. So today, I'd like to examine the history of the Ark of the Covenant. So first, let us examine how the Ark of the Covenant was first made. Moses went up to Mount Sinai a total eight times. And of all these trips, eight trips, on his sixth ascent to the Mount Sinai, on the sixth ascent to the Mount Sinai, he entered and he came down from Mount Sinai. And so this was in 1446 BC, the third month, from eighth day until the 17th of the fourth month. So for 40 days, Moses had the fasting prayer. And it was at this time that God gave Moses the pattern for the tabernacle. And that is written in Exodus chapter 25, verse 30, from chapter 25 to chapter 31. These chapters talk about the pattern of the tabernacle. Now, of this, if you see in Exodus chapter 25, verse 10 through 11, God specifies the instruction for Ark of the Covenant that is found in Exodus chapter 25, verse 10 through 11. So shall we all turn to Exodus 25, verse 10 through 11. Exodus chapter 25, verse 10 and 11.
다 같이 읽겠습니다.
So let's read together.
25장 10절 11절.
Exodus 25, verse 10 and 11.
They shall construct an ark of acacia wood,
2.5 cubits long, and 1.5 cubits wide, and 1.5 cubits high. You shall overlay it with pure gold inside and out. You shall overlay it, and you shall make a gold molding around it.
이렇게 성막의 식양을 받은 것은 제
So Moses received the pattern of a tabernacle on his sixth ascent to Mount Sinai. Now then comes the seventh ascent to Mount Sinai. This took place again in 1446 BC from the 18th of the fourth month until the 28th of the fifth month. This was the seventh ascent to Mount Sinai. Because the people of Israel sinned, Moses bore those sins upon his shoulders and interceded for the people for 40 days. Then he made eighth ascent to Mount Sinai. He made the eighth ascent to Mount Sinai, and this was in 1446 BC, on the 30th of the fifth month until the 7th of the 10th, 10th of the 7th month.
the 10th of the 7th month. So the day that he came down from the 7th of Sen was on the 28th of the 5th month. And when he went up to the 8th ascent, it was on the 30th of the 5th month. But we see there's one missing day between the two. That is the 29th of the 5th month. I hope this is not too complicated. After 28th, we have 29th and then 30th, right? So we can see that one day is missing between these two ascents. So it's 29th of the 5th month is missing from the ascent. This is what happened on the 29th. God allowed Moses to do two things. What did God tell Moses to do first? He was to cut the stone tablets. He was to prepare the stone tablets by cutting it out. So Moses cut the stones into his tablets, and so God wrote all the Ten Commandments once more on these stone tablets when he went up the Mount Sinai on the 8th ascent. Second thing that God told Moses to do is to make the ark of wood, this ark of the wood, and that this is the ark of the covenant. So the very first time the Ark of the Covenant was made was on the 29th of the 5th month. But at the time, it was only an ark or a wooden box. Right. Now, so according to the tabernacle pattern that he received on the 6th ascent, he then overlaid with the gold and made the gold moldings around it. And this happened after he came down from the 8th ascent of Mount Sinai. Now, so when the actual dedication of the Ark of the Covenant took place. It was in 1445 BC on the first day of the first month. And that is found in Exodus chapter 40, verse 2 and 3. Verse 2 specifies that it was actually on the first day of the first month of 1445 BC. Because it came down in 1446 BC, the 10th day of the 7th month. And after he came down from Mount Sinai altogether, he began in full scale the building the tabernacle according to the pattern. And he, of course, he also built the Ark of the Covenant. And then after everything was finished, and so we see in Exodus 40 verse 3, the Ark of the Covenant was placed inside the tabernacle after it was finished. So let's all turn to Exodus 40 verse 2 and 3. Exodus chapter 40 verse 2 and 3. Verse 2 reads, "On the first day of the first month, you shall set up the tabernacle of the tent of meeting. You shall place the Ark of the Testimony there, and you shall screen the Ark with the veil." So we can see that the Moses placed the Ark of the Testimony, also known as Ark of the Covenant, within the tent of within the tabernacle. So the prophecy for the Ark of the Covenant was given on the 6th ascent, and then he came down from the 7th ascent on the 28th day of the 5th month. On the 29th of the same month, he cut out the two stone tablets and made a wooden ark. And after he came down from his final 8th ascent on the 10th day of the 7th month in 1446 BC, they spent the rest of the time to build the tabernacle and the Ark of the Covenant. So finally, on 1445 BC, the first day of the first month, they placed the Ark of the Covenant inside the tabernacle. Now, this Ark of the Covenant was placed in the Solomon's temple. But afterwards, this Ark of the Covenant was actually taken by the enemies. So secondly, let us examine the process of how the Ark of the Covenant was taken away from the Israelites. The Ark of the Covenant was taken away. Now, this was in 1102 BC, during the Aphek battle, the Battle of Aphek. The Philistines came and took away the Ark of the Covenant in the Battle of Aphek. So, first, after they entered the land of Canaan, after they entered into the land of Canaan, the tabernacle was located in Gilgal, which was the very first place they came into. So from Gilgal, it moved to Shiloh. The tabernacle was relocated to Shiloh after Gilgal. So because the tabernacle was relocated, you can see the Ark of the Covenant was at first in Gilgal, and then the Ark was also relocated to Shiloh, and that is written in Joshua chapter 18, verse 1. Let's go to Joshua chapter 18, verse 1. Joshua chapter 18, verse 1. Ready? Then the whole congregation of the sons of Israel assembled themselves at Shiloh and set up the tent of meeting there, and the land was subdued before them. And then from the battle of Aphek, they lose the Ark of the Covenant to the Philistines. They lose the Ark of the Covenant to the Philistines during the Battle of Aphek. According to 1 Samuel chapter 4, verse 1, it says that they camped at Aphek. And also we see in 1 Samuel chapter 4, verse 11, the Ark of the Covenant was taken away. And verse 11 is where they lose the Ark of the Covenant to the Philistines. And when the Ark of the Covenant was taken away, Hophni and Phinehas get killed. And so we see in verse 21 that the glory of God left Israel. The glory of God left Israel. So this happened in 1102 BC. This is when the Ark of the Covenant was taken away from the Israelites. And right here we must notice this very important fact. If we see in 1 Samuel chapter 4 verse 4, we can see that Hophni and Phinehas were there with the Ark of the Covenant. 1 Samuel chapter 4 verse 4 says that Hophni and Phinehas were there with the Ark of the Covenant because they thought that because God's Ark was with them that they will not lose in this battle. They thought that they will surely win. So they treated the Ark of the Covenant of God as if some kind of a superstitious, a charm. As long as I have this with me, it doesn't matter if my faith is good or bad, whether I cherish the worship or I despise the worship. Regardless of the level or condition of my faith, as long as I have this lucky charm, that I will be okay. That was totally wrong. Yes, it is important that the Ark of the Covenant is with us. But even if the Ark of the Covenant is with you, if we do not have the faith that the Ark of the Covenant show us, if we do not have the same level of faith that is requested by the Ark of the Covenant, so while not having such a level of faith, if you think you just have the Ark of the Covenant, you'll be okay. That is totally superstitious faith. That is not true faith. So let us read 1 Samuel chapter 4, verse 4. 1 Samuel chapter 4, verse 4. So the people sent to Shiloh, and from there they carried the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord of Hosts, who sits above the cherubim. And the two sons of Eli, Hophni and Phinehas, were there with the Ark of the Covenant of God. So indeed, we can see that Hophni and Phinehas were there with the Ark of the Covenant of God. Yes, we are with the Ark of the Covenant, and therefore we will surely win in this battle against the Philistines. They were illusioned. However, what really happened is although they were together with the Ark of the Covenant of God, the center of their heart did not have the faith toward God. They did not cherish these sacrifices or offerings to God. In other words, they despised the worship to God.
So they think the worshiping God some kind of nuisance. They took worship lightly. They despise the worship and thought that as long as I'm with the Ark of the Covenant, I'm going to be well, Father's going to bless me, I'm going to be victorious. That is superstitious, a belief. You know, let's say this man that I respect so much has written down this amazing verse on my Bible. And so as long as I have this object with me, I'm going to overcome in all things. But this is true if we uphold what that man of honor wrote for me, right? If I live up to that, then we'll receive the blessings in accordance, right? But if we take the worship services as some kind of nuisance, we belittle worship services, we don't even live up to the duties and missions that God has called us, and if we say, as long as I have his writings in my house, as long as I have this Bible with this signature on it, I'm going to be well. That is really superstitious. That is not a real faith. Let's say we received this wonderful gift from him, or received this Bible verses. That means we were supposed to live according to those verses, live up to those verses, live up to these gifts, right? But if we do not perform all that and just live whatever, however we want it, we don't give a worship service, so we look down upon worship services, you know, and then if we just think to ourselves that as long as the Ark of the Covenant is with me, I'm going to be okay. But what happened is that they lost the Ark of the Covenant and they got killed in the end. So let's read 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 17. 1 Samuel chapter 2 verse 17. 1 Samuel chapter 2 verse 17. Thus the sin of the young men was very great before the Lord, for the men despised the offering of the Lord. Offering means worship services today. So when we despise worship services and think to ourselves that we are going to be well as long as we have the Ark of the Covenant, is not right. It is a superficial faith that only seeks blessings. But we must make sure that we have this faith that lives with the Ark of the Covenant in our heart. That is what's most important. We must never look down upon the worship service to God. If there is a pastor that I like is preaching, then I come to worship service. But if the pastor I don't like is going to preach, then I'm not going to go to church today. That act already is despising the worship of the Lord. The pastor is not the owner of the worship services. Father is the owner of the worship services. That pastor is only an instrument to preach the word of God. So let us never despise the worship services, because we are going to be condemned and doomed like the Hophni and Phinehas did. So as long as I have this, you know, this lucky charm or this holy gift from the man of God, and I'll be okay. Let's not think like that. Let us really cherish our worship service to our Father God and never miss out on the worship services. And I pray this blessing upon you in the name of the Lord. And so this is the reason why they lost the Ark of the Covenant. Now, thirdly, let us look at the process of how the Ark of the Covenant returned to the Israelite. So big number three is the process of the return of the Ark of the Covenant. After they lost the Ark of the Covenant, the Ark of the Covenant finally returned to Israel during the days of King David. The ark returned to the tent that was prepared in the city of David. So David prepared his tent, and to there the Ark of the Covenant returned. So in the timeline, this was in 1002 BC. So the Ark returned to Israel in 1002 BC. Remember, the Ark was lost in 1102 BC, right? 1102 BC. And so in 1002 BC is when the Ark finally returned to the city of David. That is found in 1 Chronicles chapter 15, verse 1. 1 Chronicles chapter 15, verse 1. 1 Chronicles chapter 15 verse 1. Now David built houses for himself in the city of David, and he prepared a place for the ark of God and pitched a tent for it. Now that is where the ark of God was placed. So when we look at the process, the ark was first lost to the Philistines during the Battle of Aphek. And first it went to Ashdod, and then to Gath, and then to Ekron. Then from Ekron, it was taken to Beth Shemesh. And from Beth Shemesh, the ark went to the house of Abinadab. And from the house of Abinadab, the ark went to the house of Obed-Edom. And from Obed-Edom's house, it was transferred to the city of David. So it first went to the Philistines, and within the Philistine, it went to Ashdod, Gath, and Ekron. And from there, it came into Beth-Shemesh, and then to the house of Abinadab, went to the house of Obed-Edom, and then finally to the city of David. Now, let's calculate how long this whole process of return was. How long was this return process? So first, the ark was in the Philistines for 7 months. The ark was in the Philistines for 7 months. So let's go back to 1 Samuel chapter 6, verse 1. 1 Samuel chapter 6, verse 1. And then we will see verse 11. And then 2 Samuel chapter 6, verse 10 and 11. Let's first read 1 Samuel chapter 6, verse 1. 1 Samuel chapter 6, verse 1. Let us read together. Ready? Now the ark of the Lord had been in the country of the Philistines 7 months. How many months? 7 months. So according to 1 Samuel chapter 6, verse 1, we can see the ark was in the Philistines 7 months. And the ark was transferred to Beth-Shemesh, and from the people of Beth-Shemesh transported to the house of Abinadab. So let's go to 1 Samuel chapter 7, verse 1. 1 Samuel chapter 7, verse 1. And the men of Kiriath Jearim came and took the ark of the Lord and brought it into the house of Abinadab on the hill and consecrated Eleazar his son to keep the ark of the Lord. And so from Ashdod, Gath, and Ekron, and then to Beth-Shemesh, and the men of Kiriath Jearim of Beth-Shemesh moved the ark to Abinadab's house. And then it went to the Obed-Edom's house. That is in 2 Samuel chapter 6, verse 10 and 11. So we're going to move over to 2 Samuel chapter 6, verse 10 and 11. Second Samuel chapter 6, verse 10 and 11. And David was unwilling to move the ark of the Lord into the city of David with him. But David took it aside to the house of Obed-Edom the Gittite. Thus the ark of the Lord remained in the house of Obed-Edom the Gittite 3 months. How many months? 3 months. And during that 3 months, the Lord blessed Obed-Edom and all his household. And so the ark was in the Philistines for 7 months.
왕이 될 때까지.
And until David became king.
자, 다윗이 이건 여러분 다 적으셨으니까.
So I'm sure you wrote this all now, so I'm going to erase this.
왕이 될 때까지.
Until David became king.
얼마 걸렸느냐?
How long did it take?
이게 92년이 걸렸어요.
It took 92 years.
자, 아벡 전투에서 뺏기고
The ark was lost in the battle of Aphek and so
92년이에요.
The ark was in the Philistines for 7 months and that was in 1102 BC.
다윗이 처음으로 왕이 된 게
And when David first became king when it's 1010 BC. 1010 BC. That is when David first became king. That's in 1010 BC. So from 1102 until 1010, how many years? We have 92 years. So until David became king, it took 92 years. And third, after David became king, he ruled in Hebron for 7 years and 6 months. He ruled in Hebron for 7 months and 7 years and 6 months.
그리고 나서 헤브론 통치가 끝나고
After his rule in Hebron ended, he became king over the entire Israel. So then David wanted to bring back the Ark of the Covenant. And they tried to carry the Ark on the new cart, and because oxen were startled, they tried to hold down the Ark and reached out to touch the Ark. But then the person who did that was killed. So people got all shocked, and because of this, the Ark was moved to house of Obed-Edom. We read earlier for how many months it was in the house of Obed-Edom? For 3 months. Now, after David heard that the Obed-Edom and his household were blessed, finally, at this time, David attempted the second time to bring back the Ark. This time, they did not try to transport it on the new cart, but they actually carried it upon their own shoulders. So adding all these numbers together, 92 years plus 7 years, 6 months, and 3 months, and 7 months. So we get total 100 years and 4 months. So 92 plus 7, we get 99, right? And then we add only months, 7 months plus 6 months plus 3 months, and we get 16 months, right? So 99 years and 16 months. So we know 1 year is 12 months. So we can convert this to 100 years and 4 months. 100 years and 4 months. So after they lost the Ark of the Covenant in the Battle of Aphek, they recovered the Ark after 100 years and 4 months. And the Ark finally returned to the city of David. This process of the Ark's return has never been so systematically presented by other theologians. Reverend Evan Park, he actually had thorough research in the Bible, and so he systematically explained this entire process of the Ark was taken and Ark was finally recovered. So after Solomon built the temple, he moved the ark, which was in the tent of David, back to he moved the ark from the tent of David to the Solomon's temple. So let's examine Solomon and the Ark of the Covenant first. So number four, Solomon and the Ark of the Covenant. So first, Solomon completes the temple construction.
966년
That is in he began building the temple in 966 BC, which was his fourth year of reign, and finished the temple in 959 BC. So he took total 6 years and 6 months to complete the building of the temple. So he began in the second month of his fourth year reign, and then the eighth month of his 11th year of his reign. The temple was built during this duration period.
That was in 1 Kings chapter 6, verse 1 and verse 38. So the began, the temple construction began in the fourth month of his reign and the month of Ziv, which is the second month. You all know this and you're just not responding, right? Month of Ziv is the second month. And when did the temple end? The construction ended in the 11th year of the king and the month of Abul, which is the 8th month. So it ended in the 11th month, 11th year of the king's reign on the 8th month, which is also known as month of Abul. And so after this temple was complete, Solomon placed the Ark of the Covenant that was in the city of David into this newly built Solomon's temple. That is found in 1 Kings chapter 8, verse 6. But if you see in verse 9, inside the Ark of the Covenant, there's only the stone tablet, but the other objects were not there. So what are the other objects? Aaron's rod that budded. Aaron's rod that budded, and also the jar of manna, the golden jar of manna. These two things were missing from the Ark of the Covenant. So after they lost the Ark, and it took about 100 years and 4 months to bring back the Ark. So during this process, these two objects were lost. So when Solomon placed the Ark of the Covenant into the Solomon's Temple. Inside the Ark, there was only the stone tablet. So let's turn to 1 Kings chapter 8, verse 6. 1 Kings chapter 8, verse 6. Then the priest brought the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord to its place, into the inner sanctuary of the house, to the most holy place, under the wings of the cherubim. So we can see that they finally placed the Ark of the Covenant inside the most holy place, under the wings of the cherubim. Let's read verse 9. There was nothing in the Ark except the two tablets of stone which Moses put there at Horeb, where the Lord made a covenant with the sons of Israel when they came out of the land of Egypt. So we have examined the entire history until how Ark of the Covenant was placed in the most holy place of Solomon's temple. So now, after some time, when Solomon's temple is destroyed, this is when the Ark of the Covenant disappears. When the Solomon's temple was destroyed, the Ark of the Covenant disappeared. So first, the time when the Solomon's temple was destroyed was during the third deportation to Babylon, which was in 586 BC. So the Solomon's temple was destroyed in 586 BC. That is in 2 Kings chapter 25. Let us all turn to 2 Kings chapter 25, verse 9. 2 Kings chapter 25, verse 9. Let's read verse 9 together. He burned the house of the Lord, the king's house, and all the houses of Jerusalem, even every great house he burned with fire. So verse 9 tells us that the temple of God burned down. But if we see from verse 13 through 17, we see how the armies of the Babylon transport all of their spoils of the war. Whatever was in the temple was taken to Babylon, like the great sea, right? And the two pillars, the sea is like the laver. And so you remember the two pillars, the
Boaz
and Jachin, right? So all of these holy objects, the parts in the temple, was all taken to Babylon. So you can imagine this ark, which was overlaid with gold, must have been taken at this time too. But you know what's really amazing is among the objects that are listed of the spoils for the Babylonians, it does not mention the Ark of the Covenant. This means that right before the temple was destroyed, somebody must have took the Ark of the Covenant and hid it somewhere. So some people say that they hid the Ark of the Covenant in Mount Sinai, because there is a cave known as Elijah's Cave. And some people also say that the Ark of the Covenant was sent to Ethiopia when the Queen of Sheba was. And so there were many conjectures, but there is no one to this day who knows exact location or whereabouts of the Ark of the Covenant is. But we know for sure in 586 BC, when the Solomon's Temple was destroyed, the Ark of the Covenant disappeared. And so from this point on, we will not see occurrence of the Ark of the Covenant and the rest of the Bible. So we see how the Ark of the Covenant disappeared. And so now, secondly, so afterwards, the Ark of the Covenant does not appear. So after this, the Ark of the Covenant does not appear in the Bible. Now after this, Israelites returned finally from their exile in Babylon. So after their return, they built Zerubbabel's temple. So after the return from Babylon, they built Zerubbabel's temple. So first, when was Zerubbabel's temple built? When was Zerubbabel's temple built? That was in 516 BC. 516 BC. You know, it doesn't matter how much we learn, we just are not able to memorize all of this. So I'm really thankful because you don't remember this. So how can we remember this? Destruction was in 586 BC. And God promised, after how many years will the Israelites return from Babylon? 70 years. Now 70 years, or the time frame, is always spoken in terms of the temple. So 586 BC is when the temple is destroyed. When God said they will return in 70 years, it means that the temple will be restored in 70 years. The temple return in 70 years. So exactly 70 years after the temple burned down in 516 BC, Zerubbabel's temple is built. So Jeremiah chapter 29 verse 11 through 12 says that they'll return in the return in 70 years. So it was fulfilled. So destruction is in 586 BC and 586 BC, and when it was rebuilt, that was in 516 BC, exactly 70 years after it was destroyed. Now, in Zerubbabel's temple, in the most holy place, was there the Ark of the Covenant or not? Yes, there was not the Ark of the Covenant in the Zerubbabel's temple. There was not Ark of the Covenant in the Zerubbabel's temple. So according to the Jewish traditions, in the most place of Zerubbabel's temple, they laid this great rock. So instead of the Ark of the Covenant, they placed this great rock. So on the 10th of the 7th month, which is a day of the atonement, the high priest will take the censer and go into the most holy place. There is no place to place the censer
And so that the high priest placed the censer on the rock, right? So based on this tradition, we can see that the Ark of the Covenant was not there in the Zerubbabel's temple. So in Moses' tabernacle had the Ark of the Covenant, Solomon's temple had Ark of the Covenant, but Zerubbabel's temple does not have the Ark of the Covenant. So Herodian temple is a remodeled version of the Zerubbabel's temple. So Herodian temple did not have the Ark of the Covenant either. Now in 70 AD, this Herodian temple was also completely destroyed. The person who destroyed the temple is General Titus. In order to monumentalize the Titus accomplishment, they actually built a triumphal entry for Titus. So there is a triumphant arch in the the Arch of Titus. So they built the Arch of Titus. And when we look at this Arch of Titus, it actually has the inscription of the images of what was in the Holy Temple. So it actually has a engraved drawings of the golden lampstand and all the other holy objects. Now, again, on this Arch of Titus, there is no image of the Ark of the Covenant, which also proves that the Herodian temple did not have the Ark of the Covenant either. So now we are studying Zerubbabel's temple, right? So in conclusion, we can see that the Ark of the Covenant was not in the Zerubbabel's temple. Then why is that God did not let the Ark of the Covenant to be in the Ark in the Zerubbabel's temple? So this Arch of Titus actually has image of the golden lampstand, bread, a table of the bread of presence, and all of these holy objects, but not the Ark of the Covenant. So we have examined the history of the Ark of the Covenant throughout the Bible. So in conclusion, the redemptive administration of why the Ark of Covenant was not in the Zerubbabel's temple. So that's the conclusion of today's lecture. Why the reason the Ark of the Covenant was not in the Zerubbabel's temple. So redemptive administration, why the Ark of the Covenant was not in the Zerubbabel's temple? Why is Ark of the Covenant missing in Zerubbabel's temple? First, it is the fulfillment of the Word of God. It is a fulfillment of the word or the prophecy of God. Actually, that was in our main text, in Jeremiah chapter 3, verse 16. It says, in the days when people are multiplied and increased in the land, they will no longer think about the Ark of the Covenant. They will no longer make it again. So already prophet Jeremiah had prophesied this long ago. He prophesied that there will be a day that we will not need the Ark of the Covenant, right? But that was finally fulfilled with the Zerubbabel's temple. Let us go back to Jeremiah chapter 3, verse 16, our main text. Jeremiah chapter 3, verse 16. It shall be in those days when you are multiplied and increased in the land, declares the Lord. And it will not, and they will no longer say, the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord. And it will not come to mind, nor will they remember it, nor will they miss it, nor will it be made again. So clearly God prophesied through prophet Jeremiah that people will no longer talk about the Ark of the Covenant, will not think about the Ark of the Covenant, will not remember it, will not miss it, nor will it be made again. And it was truly fulfilled. Now, secondly,
covenant 주체이신
The true entity of the Ark of the Covenant is Jesus Christ. And so this is the message that says we must hold on to Jesus Christ, who is a true reflection of the Ark of the Covenant. He is a true entity of the Ark of the Covenant. What can you imagine if we have the Ark of the Covenant to this day? Millions, zillions of people would come to the Ark of the Covenant believing that as long as they stand or see the Ark of the Covenant, they will be blessed, their descendants will prosper, and they will win in the battle. So it doesn't matter how much money they would cost them, they will all want to come to the Ark of the Covenant. So the Ark of the Covenant will actually become exalted higher than the God himself. They will probably to make the Ark of the Covenant as an idol and worship it. And so God took away the Ark of the Covenant so we can hold on to the true entity of the Ark of the Covenant, which is Jesus Christ. Because we human beings get stuck on the visible things. Can you imagine if our church had the Ark of the Covenant? Everybody want to come to this Ark of the Covenant and bow down before the Ark of the Covenant. But please remember, Hophni and Phinehas were there with the Ark of the Covenant, but they still lost in the battle. Why? Because the object, the Ark of the Covenant itself is not what's important, but the faith that is requested by the Ark of the Covenant is what's more important. Therefore, we must cherish the worship services more. We must meet our Father God through the worship services. Now, that is a way of living with the Ark of the Covenant in our heart. So without fulfilling this, if we were to hold on to just the visible object, even if it were the Ark of the Covenant, it will not mean anything. So God knew that if we held the Ark of the Covenant, it will become greater than God himself. That's why God took it away altogether. So let us not hold on to the shadow of things, the copy of things, but hold on to what is true. That is why in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 25, as Jesus gave the cup and he's getting the during the Last Supper, he says this cup is the new covenant that he established by his blood. So in Hebrews chapter 9 verse 15, in Hebrews chapter 12 verse 24, also says that Jesus is the mediator of the new covenant. Jesus is the mediator of the new covenant. Jesus is the mediator, the true nature, true entity of the new covenant. So let us not hold on to the shadow or copy of things, but hold on to what is true, the actual substance, and that is Jesus Christ. So ultimately, Zerubbabel's temple, Zerubbabel's temple is the temple where Jesus Christ will come. The Zerubbabel's temple is a temple that Jesus Christ would come. Now, Zerubbabel's temple, because the true substance is Jesus Christ, and so God gave Zerubbabel's temple so that ultimately we can meet Jesus Christ. So when Jesus Christ comes to the Zerubbabel's temple, we must surrender to Jesus Christ. We must receive Jesus Christ. So Jesus Christ is actually greater than the temple itself, but the people were only holding on to this visible temple. They just only got stuck with worshiping temple there, and we give offerings to God there in the temple, that I will be blessed. Missing out the real essence. So we must know that even the Zerubbabel's temple was given so that the people can ultimately receive Jesus Christ. That was the purpose of God giving the Zerubbabel's temple in the first place. That's why in Malachi chapter 3 verse 1 he says, Malachi chapter 3 verse 1 prophesies that the Messiah will come to this temple. This is where God's glory will be manifested, and the treasure of all nations will come to this temple. The treasures of all nations will come to this temple, and this treasure of all nations is referring to Jesus Christ. That is in book of Haggai chapter 2. Haggai chapter
chapter 2, verse 7. Let us read this verse together. Haggai chapter 2, verse 7. Haggai chapter 2, verse 7. I will shake all the nations, and they will come with the wealth of all nations, and I will fill this house with glory, says the Lord of hosts. It says that God's glory will fill this house. When? When the wealth of all nations come. And this wealth, the true treasure, is Jesus Christ. So when the temple receives this wealth of all nations, then the temple will truly fulfill its purpose. So I pray that here in Moriah, we will also be able to meet the wealth of all nations, which is our Lord Jesus Christ. And I pray this blessing upon us and upon our nation, Republic of Korea, in the name of the Lord. Let us continue next hour concerning this wealth of all nations. Let us now pray. Let us sing hymn number 432 and pray together. We will first pray for our nation and our people, and secondly, let's pray for our summer conference. It will start from July 29th, and also the summer conference for the ministers that will begin from August 5th. And also our church is facing many hardships and afflictions. However, our Father God, who has protected our church thus far, will continue to protect our church. So let us firmly hold on to this conviction and pray that God will protect this nation to the end. Let us also pray for our brothers and sisters who may be ill or sick.
하나님 아버지,
Our Father, our God, again today, by your power and majesty and terror, we have bowed down before you. Still in North Korea, there are many of our brothers who are suffering the hunger and affliction and persecution. Father, we pray that you will hasten the day of peaceful unification for free democracy so that the word of redemptive history, your word of life, will be delivered all the way up to North Korea, and many of our God's people who are in suffering be able to return to the bosom of our Father God. Father, in July 29th, and until August 1st, we're going to have our summer conference. From August 5th until the 7th, we will have the minister's summer conference. Father, we pray that you will govern from the beginning all the way to the end, so that your grace will abound and the great power from above will be experienced in every soul who are present there. So through this summer conference, that all of us will become the central figures of redemptive history that are pleasing to you. Father, to this day, by your majesty and terror, you have kept the Pyeonggangjae Church to this day. Therefore, no matter what suffering, hindrances, or tribulation there may be, we know and we believe that you will take care of us to the end. You have solely taken care of Pyeonggangjae Church, and you have established this church as a church of a high priest, so that we can truly deliver your message to the end of the world, to the end of the days. Father God, we have brought many issues before you, for we are not able to take care of this with our own strength. Father, there are illnesses and problems and sufferings. We leave it all up to you. We put our hand on the right, put our right hand on our chest, believing that this is not our right hand, but this is your hand that is still flowing with the undrained blood that you shed on the cross. At this time, I command by name of Jesus Christ, may all illnesses be driven out. May all the darkness and forces of evil that trying to plunge his church into darkness and problem, may all this darkness be driven out. Now I command by name of Jesus Christ, may all bodies be completely healed and be strong. May all houses receive blessings, both physically and spiritually. Our Father God, we learn that Hophni and Phinehas, although they were with the Ark of the Covenant, they despised the worship services. Father, we pray that we will not do the same until the day of our transfiguration. Help us to keep the worship services by faith as you have commanded us. Father, we believe that you fulfill all of our prayer requests today, and we pray all of this in the precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
큰 은혜를 받았습니다.
We were greatly blessed. Let us have time of offering.
준비해 주시길 바랍니다. 기도하시겠습니다.
Let us pray.
고맙고 감사하신 하나님 아버지,
Father God, we are ever so thankful to you.
이렇게 목요 구국 예배로 인도해 주시고,
You have led us to this Thursday worship service for our nation,
and blessed us immensely through today's message.
So we thank you so much, Father.
실체이신 예수님을 늘 마음속에 품고,
Father, please help us to cherish our Lord Jesus Christ, who is a true entity of the Ark of the Covenant, so that we can always live a blessed life. We are so thankful for all the loving kindness that you have bestowed upon us. So we dedicate these offerings to you. Father, please take these offerings with gladness and joy and answer all of our prayer requests. Wherever these offerings are used, may only your glory be revealed and expand the horizon of the word of redemptive history. Father, please remember every hand that offered this gift to you. Open the gates of heaven to them and reward them 1,000, 10,000 fold. We commit everything to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you for blessing us to praise your name. Deborah Choir have given thanksgiving offering. Shin Hae Jung gave thanksgiving offering.
And
many other thanksgiving offerings being given to God, as well as a tithe offerings. I'm sure that God gladly accepted all of our offerings today. We have announcements to share as a following today. First, the summer conference with a theme, Let Us Become Leaders of Redemptive History by Receiving Great Power from Above, will begin on July 29th, Monday, until Thursday, August 1st in Yeoju Pyeonggang Jeolla Conference Center. And also, 2019 summer conference for ministers will begin on August 5th, on Monday, until Wednesday, the 7th at Yeoju Pyeonggang Jeolla Conference Center. Also, there will be a special book launching Thanksgiving service for the second Huison Sermon book entitled And the Absolute Thanksgiving from an Emptied Heart on July 31st on Wednesday. And for the book launching service, the 4,000 choir will be also present. So we'd like to have a special practice service after on Lord's Days. Until ask all to bring their own choir
amount. 두 번째 광고로 하계 대성회의 접수는 7월 14일
This is for the registration for the summer conference. The registration has already begun. You register at the church office and for Zion Sanctuary. It will actually receive the registration next this coming Lord's Day after second service. And the first floor, then the parking ground for is second education hall. Simeon and Jonathan is 40,000. Zion is 30,000. Moriah is 20,000. And registration fee for adults will be 10,000 won. For children, 5,000 won. For middle schoolers to elementary school to high schoolers. Bus fees at 20,000 and 10,000 won for children if they take up seats. The bus fees are not refundable.
We'll
give out the parking tickets
through a department.
And we'd like to ask you to register by 21st at Men's Ministry Office. Let us all rise and sing doxology and conclude the service with the pastor's benediction. Now the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, abounding love of our Father God, and inspiration, fellowship, fullness, and indwelling of the Holy Spirit upon all those who desire to hold on to Jesus Christ as a true entity of the Ark of the Covenant to the very end, upon their families, workplaces, businesses, and the church, be from now and forever, evermore. Amen.
Thank you.